I am Eduardo Solis, and this is 300 Seconds Plus, Episode 2, Con Talk. I'm here with my friend Chris Holm, and we're going to have a not-quite-so-brief discussion about the various conventions that we've been to. So say hi to the nice people, Chris.
Hey, everybody. How's it going?
Thanks a lot, and I think we'll start from the beginning. What was the first con that you had ever been to? Now, keep in mind, we're going to be talking about fan conventions, not necessarily the big giant ones like E3 and all that good stuff.
Yeah, I guess the first fan convention I ever went to was probably Zero Day Anime, which was at Our Lady of the Lake University. And it's like from then on, I was just hooked. And that was an anime convention. And I had never been to a convention before, except maybe a small Comic-Con here and there as a kid.
Oh, okay.
And that was like my first exposure to con conventions. And from then on, it's like, since then I've been going to, like, I guess, anime cons like San Japan and Realms Con. And then I tried another thing. I tried a Comic Con, which was Texas Comic Con. And then there was a steampunk convention, which was something completely different called Etherfest. Now, these are all local San Antonio conventions. I want to point that out.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it's pretty interesting to note that the number of conventions here in town seems to be on the rise, which I think is a good thing, you know, especially considering that all the cool stuff tends to head up I-35 to Austin and we get left out.
Yeah, it's either, you know, everything is either happening in either Dallas or Houston or Austin. It's never here.
Where's the love, man? Anyway, as for myself, my first convention, actually, I was gonna say San Japan 1.x or whatever they called it, but even before then, I had gone to one. I was at the first Realms Con a number of years ago, and the funny thing was, I went because of a friend who wanted to get the autograph of the actress that played Deanna Troi in Star Trek: The Next Generation, and she was real nervous about being around celebrities, so. You know, but for that, I probably wouldn't have gone at all. And I've also been to quite a few of the same cons that Chris has mentioned.
What kind of a convention would you say at the time Realms Con was? Because it pretty much credits itself as a multi-genre fan convention. So would you say at the time it was more of a sci-fi comic book convention or more of an anime convention or...
You know, I would say it was more of a sci-fi convention back then. You know, I don't really recall seeing a lot of anime at the event. You know, but then again, at the time, I wasn't really looking for it. You know, so and they had I believe it was Peter Mayhew, the gentleman who played Chewbacca, and Aaron Gray, whose autograph I got at the time. You know, so I'd have to say, just, you know, off the top of my head, I might be dead wrong. You know, but I think it was more of a sci-fi thing at the start.
Yeah, you know, so I guess we could probably, you know, put it in there like pretty much as like what classic Comic-Con, like closest to our Texas Comic-Con, which happened just recently.
Well, at the time, and then yeah. I think it kind of mutated into an anime convention as years went by, and now they kind of, especially with last year, you know, they're trying to steer more toward that, having a variety of different guests, you know, because they had those horror guests this past year, in addition to the, you know, the usual suspects at with the voice actors at anime cons and all that good stuff.
Yeah. Now let's get back on to local grounds. Let's first discuss, I guess, what we want to talk about mostly is the culture at the conventions. Like, what kind of an atmosphere is it? Do you feel at each of these different events, and how they're all different, and how they're all the same?
Yeah, because there is a lot, even though they're covering different genres of, you know, geekdom, nerddom, whatever you want to call it. Yeah, I mean, there's certain similar elements, but at the same time, they each kind of have their own culture, you know, and yeah, I mean, for what it's worth, they're all kind of different. So we'll go ahead and start off with talking about anime cons.
All right.
And what we like and don't like about them and all that good stuff.
Okay, I guess as far as, you know, what we like about, or what I like about them, is that there's pretty much, it's, you know, a very active, very, I guess, youth-oriented culture, I guess. I see lots of, you know, lots of kids are there.
Right.
And it's you know, it's very interesting, and there's a lot to see and a lot to do. And the guests are pretty unique, but unless you know you watch a lot of animes and stuff, or you're on the internet a lot, you're not going to really know who most of these people are.
Right.
But if you're like watched like a few episodes of Cowboy Bebop, you'll recognize some of the names of the guests. Like let's bring up San Japan. San Japan was very fun, and it had lots of stuff going for it, and a lot of stuff. I mean, they had panels upon panels.
Right.
So you could always find a panel. There were viewing rooms which had anime playing. There was a dealer's alley and an artist alley. And there's pretty much, you know, I guess, even, you know, mild gaming going on.
Right, exactly. Yeah. And for the uninitiated, a dealer's room would be where you have people selling, you know, stuff like T-shirts or comic books or DVDs. And artist alley, you usually have, you know, artists selling, you know, fan art and their own artwork, doing commissions and all that good stuff. Yeah, and I agree. I mean, anime cons, the one thing I like about them is that they tend to have a very interesting variety of things to see and do, and also the you know, because of the nature of anime itself, it covers so many different genres. You know, there's all kinds of, you know, sci-fi and you know, there's all kind of different anime, and so you never know what you're going to see at these things. You know, I can't say I keep up with the scene myself, so I don't. For me, it's always something new because I don't really, you know, keep up with it as much as I used to.
And that can sort of be helpful, but at the same time, it can also hurt for like just general people walking off the street, because if you're not into what's hot at the moment, you're going to see a lot of people, like the people who go to these conventions. They're going to be like, you know, the enthusiasts, the cosplayers, and all that. They're going to be dressed up as these sort of from characters from series that you're not going to recognize. And that's one of the things that I notice, is that it's gearing more towards, I guess it's faster paced. It's a faster paced moving culture where one year something's popular and then next year something completely different is hugely popular.
Yeah, and the other thing is gone.
And if you're not in the know, then you're going to be pretty much left behind.
Yeah, it's really... I would say that an anime con for a first-time goer or somebody that's new, you know, to it, it's a bit harder to assimilate, you know, because there's just so much.
And it's just, and there's not just so much, but there's so much, and it's so, it comes at you pretty much all at once, is this sort of, you know, rabid fandom. And a lot of it is, you know...
Yeah, I'll buy that.
I guess it's sort of, I guess it's changing over the years, where the demographics or the common con goer for these shows is getting much, much younger. And it's pretty much being taken over by young 14-year-old girls.
Right.
And if you're just like a regular person like us, you know, of the, like you're either late 20s or early 30s, you're walking into this environment and you're pretty much... You know, most of the characters and the cosplayers are unrecognizable. Like, say, if you were at a Comic-Con, you could see someone dressed up as a stormtrooper, and that would be immediately recognizable. But at an anime convention, you see someone in a giant suit of armor, and you have no idea what it is. It's like, is that from Full Metal Alchemist, or is it from, like, DeGreymon? What? I don't know.
Yeah, it definitely slants a lot more toward the younger folks. You know, it also makes it, I guess, the atmosphere a little more electric, you know, because you have all these manic kids running around and just, you know, just, I don't know, just running around and being crazy, which kind of can be a negative.
Yeah, which also hurts it, because you have all this, I guess, ludicrous, obnoxious youth-based behavior. And since most of these kids, they didn't grow up like how we grew up.
Oh boy.
Where we had to hunt down our anime on VHS tapes. We couldn't get this instant gratification. And I guess that's why the theme of far as what's popular one year to the next jumps so quickly. Because they have this instantaneous access to whatever it is that they want. You know, they'll either get it through the fan subs, and then the Funimation or whoever it is decides, oh, that's a popular show. let's dub it and sell it to the kids, and then so that way we could at least make some money or something, or license it right away.
Yeah, and that's kind of the way things work these days. I mean, everything is just so darn fast, you know, thanks to the internet. You know, whereas back in the day, you know, you're lucky, you know, if you didn't go to, you know, I guess, you know, comic or animation conventions back then, you know, back in the good old days of the 80s, when it was called Japanimation, you know, you had the, you know, hope that maybe your local video store, you know, got something from, yeah, I think, was it Streamline? Remember those guys?
Yeah, it was like Streamline, ADV, or ADV is sort of mid-90s, but Streamline, it was like Manga Core or something of that nature.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about those guys.
And it was, you know, you had your Bubblegum Crisis, you had your Fist of the North Star.
Dirty Pair was one of my my first animes.
And the thing is, stuff like that, it stuck around for a good few years, and it was good enough to sate our appetite.
Yeah, I'll buy that.
I guess for the cultural references and stuff. And nowadays, there's just so many series coming out. And it's where I'm sort of, you know, bombarded and overstimulated with all these different types of characters.
Yeah, it moves a lot faster.
And it's hard to really, you know, latch on to a series and say, oh, I like this, or oh, I like this, when, like, next month something new completely drops and everybody is like, on board, you know, full steam ahead for some type of new show, like Hitalia or something.
Oh boy.
Yeah.
Well, and another positive I'd say for the anime folks is that I think you mentioned this earlier, would be the variety of things that you can do there, the all the different panels that they have.
Yeah, there's more panels. And I'd have to say this also is that the celebrities, who are usually voice actors, they're more involved in the fan community. I mean, at a Comic-Con, you might get lucky, you know, to have one panel with a celebrity guest, whereas at an anime-con, you know, a particular, you know, voice actor or voice actress may host several panels.
Oh, yeah, they're all over the place.
And they're also giving workshops and also doing lots of other stuff.
Yeah, sometimes even DJing.
Yeah, because they're pretty much, you know, I mean, I don't want to sound negative saying this, but, you know,
yeah, you
I
do.
Mean, okay, they're not paying their house payment on anime alone. They're doing lots of other stuff and making these appearances and doing all these other things. They have other jobs. And they can, you know, oftentimes, you know, bring that over into the anime workshops and have fun with it. Like, say, for instance, let me bring up this voice actor, Christopher Ayers. You know, I mean, he's in a lot of series, but he's also a theater director. And he brings that into the panels where he'll do these mock combat sessions.
Oh, yeah.
And he also does a lot of improv comedy and a lot of other different stuff. And he just has so many hats that there's so many different things that he does at all these different cons. And he's very active and involved with the community directly.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, he's, you know, and that's, you know, one reason that I, you know, the guy is so popular, you know, is that he's so, you know, he's so, he's out there, you know. If it's not doing one thing, it's another. And, you know, that's awesome. I mean, it's very rare, I think, you know, for fans to really have that level of interaction with, you know, with the actors and actresses that they enjoy.
Yeah, whereas, like, let's say, example, at a Comic-Con, you know, maybe you just get, like, maybe one panel with a guest, or maybe that guest is just under some kind of contract. They can only be at the convention for, like, so many hours. They're not going to be there all day. They may be there for, like, a set number of hours, and then you can only get an autograph and a picture with them, and then that's it. And then, or, like, let's say...
Now, to be fair, you know, the guests at comic book conventions tend to be, or at least the ones we've been to, you know, tend to be a bit bigger. You know, they tend to be household names. You know, like, you know, like, people might not necessarily know who Brent Spiner is, but they've probably heard of, you know, Lieutenant Data from Star Trek.
Yeah, and, you know, and it's, you know, and because he's such a huge name, you know, there's, it's not that I'm pretty sure, I'm not going to say that he doesn't want to be more involved. It's just, you know, just due to the nature of it, they simply can't have that. you know, because it's just because we don't know what the contracts are or how much they, because, you know, one day they might be there for the whatever allotted time that they're supposed to be. Then they have to get up and go and do something else or do some other film project or whatever.
Yeah, or catch a plane.
Yeah, there's always some place they have to be.
Yeah, exactly.
And they cannot, you know, they just can't be as involved, or it's just simply not in the culture that they are as involved. You know, there's that high expectation is simply not placed upon them. And many of them really don't, you know, try to aspire to it.
Well, I mean, that's I think that's really an individual thing. You know, I'm pretty sure, you know, some would like to, but, you know, as you said, they've got other commitments and all that good stuff.
Yeah, and there's just not, you're not going to see 20 different panels of, you know, Dance Dance Revolution with Commander Data. You're not going to see that at a Comic-Con. It would be really cool, but, you know.
Yeah, I was going to say, that would be awesome.
But, you know, I mean, that's just not the nature of what they do, you know, because it's just them showing up. You know, that's enough. That's enough to sate the hunger of the con culture, of the con goers. That's pretty much all they want.
And also importantly, you know, to attract attention and get people, you know, to go.
Yeah, they,
I mean, because I don't know how many people I talk to are like, oh my God, you know, Brent Spiner's going to be there, you know, give me an autograph. I'm like, I'm going to be busy at my table. I don't think I'll be able to get one for myself, which, you know, sadly I didn't, but oh well.
Yeah. And then there's and then another one is like, I guess, steampunk conventions where, you know, there the guests are, well, they're all, let me put this, self-made. They're all these you know, self-made celebrities who went out there and made themselves a name within the steampunk community. And, you know, they're flown in, and a lot of them have, you know, varying. They either they sing or they dance or they have impressive costumes. And there, when I noticed when I was at Etherfest, which was the Texas's first steampunk convention.
Well, three-day steampunk convention. Yeah, you gotta underline that. There's been others before, but they were the first ones to do the whole weekend thing.
And when I went down there, you know, I had a table across from like a guest. And he was like rarely ever at his table, not because he didn't want to be, but you know, there was just he had his table stationed, and he would be out and about giving panels and entertaining the guests. I would say they'd probably be somewhere between, you know, the anime con guest, like a voice actor, and you know, celebrity, like, you know, like a movie star or something.
Well, yeah, named celebrity. Right?
Yeah, they're out there and they're doing things, you know. And if when he only came to his table, it was just to catch his breath, you know, and sit down for a little bit.
Yeah, kind of to escape.
Yeah, you know. You know. I mean, and then people would come by and maybe he'd sell something like a gadget or a doohickey or whatever it is that they produce
to sell. Or promote his group. I believe he had a group or a club or something like along those lines.
Yeah, I'm pretty – they all did. And these are all, you know, then they're all self-made names. Which is, you know, really awesome, because that's what I like about the steampunk culture is you don't have to necessarily be a voice actor or an actor. You can become a name if you just go out there and do something and make yourself.
Well, do something creative. Yeah, and I would dare say more artsy.
Yeah, it's more of an
you know, like people that make the big giant, you know, intricate guns, you know, that look really cool or artwork.
Yeah,
or maybe even, you know, I don't know, comic books. You know,
another thing that I've noticed is there's quite a, in the steampunk genre, I've seen a lot of these celebrities, or a lot of the named guests that they have are authors. They're all writers.
Right.
And there's very, very few artists in there. I think...
Well, so far.
So far. You know. I think myself and another artist... We're like probably the only artists at Etherfest. I could be wrong, but, you know, just looking at it, the rest are, you know, crafters, and that is another form of art. But it's not exactly line art, as I would say. and it is, you know, it's fantastic. It's fantastic. And it's a great thing. And
well, and there are a lot of people that make clothes as well. You know, that's something. I mean, you do see a few, you know, costume makers and hat makers and all that good stuff at anime cons. But I mean, you could get you could, you know, pretty much fit yourself you know, from the tip of your toes to the top of your head at a steampunk con. I mean,
pretty much all you got to bring it. I mean, you can get yourself completely steampunked out. And they're ready to, you know, gear you up, so to speak.
Oh yeah, you got the cash. I mean, they'll dude you up real good and you know have you looking real nice and all that good stuff.
And that's something else that I noticed is, as far as I guess we were talking earlier about assimilation into the culture, how with anime it's kind of hard because there's so much to keep up with, and you have to be so much in the know. But with steampunk, it's very easy to pick up. I mean, you can steampunk anything, and you can make yourself whatever you want. It's pretty much a do-it-yourself fandom, and I guess that's what drew me to it, because I see it as it's what you bring to it. You know, you make it what you bring to it, or something like that.
Yeah, exactly. And because, you know, except maybe for, you know, I guess stuff like Jules Verne, you know, or I believe it was the sketches that I think it was Da Vinci, you know, the ornithopter and the hang gliders and all the stuff that he did. Outside of, you know, stuff like that, there really isn't a hard and fast definition of what steampunk is. So you can really make it, you know, whatever you want. And then it's just a matter of, you know, getting it out there, you know, and getting your crew, I guess is what it's called. I was about to say posse, but I don't think that fits the steampunk mold, you know, together and all that good stuff.
Or your I guess, airship, as I guess they would call it. That's a more popular term.
Well, right, but that's but it's a crew. You know,
it's you know, get your gang.
Semantics.
Your gaggle, your troop.
whatever they call it, you know.
Whatever steam they call it.
Steam army. Oh, there you go. Your army of steam.
Yeah. And then I guess, you know, and that's what I like about it too. It's very easy to assimilate, and the steam culture is very, you know, welcoming, which is what I've noticed too. And in the Comic-Con, it's not really, you know, you don't have to dress up, but, you know, you can dress up as, like, say, the Green Lantern, and there are all these, it's, I guess at Comic-Con, the culture is more, you know, when you dress up or something, it's more of along the lines of, you know, recognizable, extremely recognizable characters. And that's another thing that's pretty cool at the Comic-Cons as far as the culture and costuming, is that people dress up. You know, you'll recognize Captain America right away, whereas right. At an anime con, you may not recognize, you know, the chick from Final Fantasy VI,
right, or Italy from Italia,
whatever ethnic country from World War II to Vietnam or something in the Italia, whatever it is, that you know, it's. I mean, you might think, oh, that person is dressed up as a Nazi from Indiana Jones. It's like, no, they're dressed as
the country itself.
As the country, you know. Yeah, it's like, oh.
As personified by, you know, Hitalia or whatnot.
As a personified country.
Yeah, and I'd have to say the other thing with the comic cons is that, you know, it isn't necessarily about comics. You know, it's about comics and pretty much pop culture in general. You know, because I've seen... You know, in addition to the usual, you know, actors from science fiction shows, you know, we've seen wrestlers, you know, we've seen, you know, actors from sitcoms.
Yeah, and also I've seen lots of, you know, there's also lots of elements of sci-fi into it, with like a huge Star Wars presence, a huge Doctor Who presence, which is actually on the rise, and yep. Doctor Who is just exploding. It's even exploding into the anime cons, where the cosplayers there are dressing up as Doctor Who characters.
Right, right, right.
And, of course, one of the things is, you know, as far as, you know, the culture goes in the anime cons, there's pop culture, but there's also more, I guess, internet culture, or memes are very dominant.
Our very own San Japan is going to be bringing some of those guys over here this year. I mean, the name of the con itself is, you know, For the Win. You know, so I guess that's to be expected. I mean, who are they having this year?
I guess the guy who created the Nyan Cat. I'm pretty sure I'm not saying that correctly, but I'm not going to try to.
You're close enough. I think that's. And then there's
another guest who actually animated a bunch of cartoons for, I guess, Newgrounds comic called the Awesome Series, which is a parody series that parodies gaming culture, which is a very fun series. It's very humorous.
Yeah, I still haven't seen it. That's kind of on my to-do list.
Yeah, well, from what I've seen, I've enjoyed it. It's a great series.
Oh, okay.
And that's you know, mainly from internet. And of course, you'll have, you know, your usual gaggle of voice actors, which is, you know, tremendous because they're so involved and they're practically literally doing cartwheels for you.
Yeah. Oh, that would be a neat panel.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I mean, Christopher Ayers, I'm pretty sure he could do a cartwheel. He's just got to put his giant, you know, 80-ounce jug down for 5 minutes, which is, you know, I guess really hard to do since, you know, he practically, it's like Thor's hammer with him.
The thing's the size of his head, so yeah, I'm pretty sure he could, you know, lay the smack down with it if the need arose.
Yeah, and then at the, I guess, the Comic Cons.
I think, you know, as far as friendliness towards, you know, friendliness towards, you know, newbies, you know, Comic Cons would probably be the easiest one for somebody to get to.
Yeah,
you know, because more than likely you're going to see something you recognize.
Yeah, it's the most recognizable one, and you don't have to dress up to enjoy it. Whereas at a steampunk con, it is great, but you get more out of it if you dress up.
Yeah, I remember you gave me grief on Saturday, I believe it was, because I didn't dress up.
Yeah.
You know, but you know, to be fair, you know, I felt obligated not to dress up because I gave him crap over insinuating that you needed to be dressed up to be there. So I kind of set myself up for that.
Yeah, you don't have to dress up. But it's more enjoyable if you dress up, you know, because it's more the steampunk cons, they're more atmospheric. And I guess hosting at the St. Anthony Hotel, you know, and after you just look through your own drawers, you see that it's very easy to dress up steampunk.
Yeah, I mean, I half-assed something, you know, on Saturday myself, you know, so... You know, I basically grabbed the flat cap and some suspenders, and you know, I look like I almost fit in. You know.
Yeah, I mean, it was a good job that it's, you know, it's easy to fit in if you just, you know, try a little bit. It doesn't take that much effort, but it's not like trying to fit in at an anime con, where you know it's pretty much, you know, full on. You know, you got to get your country right. Or something, and the cosplay culture there is like very strict.
Oh boy, here we go with the cosplayers. Let it out, man.
Well, I mean, you know, the cosplay, they're all like younger, and I guess they have, you know.
Well, they have the time for one thing.
Yeah, and the cosplay is more intricate, and I guess the competition is more fierce. And from what I've seen, that these people, they dress up, I mean, it's all for fun. But there are those few who take it a bit too seriously.
Just a teensy.
That, you know, I just say, you know, that they see themselves as, you know, as actors or something that I think you pointed out in one of our private conversations about how, you know, they view themselves. They put themselves on a high perch.
You right.
know, and
yeah, I mean, well, I mean, it's one thing to have, you know, a cool costume, but I mean... You know, at the end of the day, you're just a person in a cool costume. I mean, unless you've actually been in some kind of production or whatever, you know, it's cool to role play and all that. Yeah, I mean, just don't go off the deep end.
Yeah, I mean, some of these people, I just say this. They act as though the wig doesn't come off.
Nice.
And it's like...
I like that.
And it's like they're... and I guess they sort of have this sort of attitude and where, you know... Dressing up in a costume isn't just a hobby, it's a lifestyle. You know, it's just, you know, it's like stronger than homosexuality.
Good night, everybody. Show's over.
Or, you know,
we're banned. Sorry. I'm banned. You know, Jackass here can say whatever he wants. Ain't going to bother him any.
I mean, it's just it's just this sort of, you know, I mean, there are a few cases like this. Most of the people, they understand.
I hear what you're
it's just
saying.
Fun.
I mean, yeah, most of them are, you know, yeah, they're having fun.
And then there are some that, you know, that just, you know, the few bad apples that just ruin it for everybody. And I guess, you know, but there aren't you know, I guess as many as there were before or whatever. But they're out there.
Oh, well, what can you do, right?
Yeah.
Now, Chris is going to have a little more experience. Actually, he's going to have 100% more experience than I do going on to gaming conventions. Now, while I have been to E3 myself, and you really should have gone that one year, the I don't really count that one because it's a very polished, very, you know, high dollar, big money, whatever, whatever. It's not a fan con. It's a business thing. And
it's an industry event.
Yeah, exactly. There you go. It's an industry convention, and I can't really put it on the same level as, you know, these other things. So I'll let go ahead and let you talk about the gaming conventions.
Yeah, there was another gaming convention called SGC, which was, I guess, in Dallas. And I went up there with OG, and I found that it was like a pretty much a mix of everything. It was as fun as an anime convention in that there was so much to do. Of course, most of the names probably weren't all that recognizable because they were either journalists, developers, or CEOs who owned a company or something of that nature, or net celebrities like the Keith Abernathy. I don't know if I'm saying that correctly. And then the video game, angry video game nerd, that they were all pretty much, you know, they were running the show, and it was, you know, for the Screw Attack crew. And I guess if you know who they are, then yeah, you're going to be excited to see them because they produce their own content for their own website. And it's exciting, I guess, you know.
Well, I mean, they're what I suppose we would call, you know, and I think you used this term earlier, internet famous.
Yeah, they're
you know, they're well known within their respective communities, you know, in this case being gamers, but they're not exactly household names. Not that that's necessarily a bad thing, but, you know, as you said, you're not, you know, if you're a first timer, you're not necessarily going to know who all these people are. I mean, I don't know half the names you just mentioned. I have no earthly idea who they are.
But if you're in the zone, so to speak.
Well, then, if you're part of that audience, yeah. If you're
then, it's a very exciting event. And there's like, I guess, you know, and it was a very happy, you know, fun convention.
And that's the important thing.
I mean, was sort
so
of
long
like,
as everybody's having fun.
It was sort of a crossover of everything else. You know, but it's. I'll tell you one thing. It's not. It's not like a gaming tournament, which I guess is the closest that we can find to any gaming related events happening. Is, you know, it's like a gaming tournament.
Oh, you mean like the ones that our mutual friend Oscar puts on, or?
I mean,
we're in a pretty dry area as far as gaming stuff goes. It's like everything happens in Dallas as far as gaming goes.
Yes, but as far as gaming, you know, cons, there aren't that many, not here in the city.
That's true.
The closest you get to any type of gaming event is either a tournament someplace.
Oh, that's true. Very
good
point.
And you know, and I guess there's no you know, anime watching tournaments or anything like that. There's no comic reading tournaments other than, you know, I guess the 24-hour comic book event, which happens every once in a while.
I think it's an annual thing, but
it's an annual thing. And
and it's kind of the nature of the beast. I mean, you know, I mean, it's kind of weird when you think about it because, you know, a gaming, you know, event to a certain degree is going to be about the gamers.
Yeah, it's going to be about, you know, gamers and the games and all that and whatever's related to that industry, and I guess just playing in a tournament, you know, that is pretty cool. And I guess some of these, you know, where they're the gamers are sort of, you know, I guess the stars at a tournament.
Yeah, that's a good analogy. Yeah. You know, I mean, if you're good enough, you know, like Fatality or Star Slayer, you know, any of the Justin Wong, you know, then yeah, I mean that, you know, that's
or Chris Gold.
Ah, yeah, our old buddy Chris Gold. Well, your old buddy. I've never had the pleasure.
Or Billy Mitchell. I've never met him. All I know is that Oscar talks about him. He's something special. So I guess I'll take his word for it.
Well, that depends on what kind of special you're talking about. You know, there's special, and then there's, you know, special short bus special. You know, so.
But yeah,
I'm not sure if he's reaching from column A or column B. So
could be either one, knowing Oscar.
Yeah.
And by the way, that's, you know, OG, Original Gamer Podcast, blah, 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 but we don't care about them.
Nah, not really. We're only going to be on that one tomorrow, so whatever.
Yeah.
you know, I only write, edit, you know, do voices and all this other stuff for the site. So, forget those guys. This is my show. Yeah.
Oh, and another thing I want to touch on is, you know, since this got me thinking about gaming tournaments, one thing I never see at gaming tournaments, of course, is girls.
Yeah, he went there.
And that's, you know, whenever you see a girl at a gaming tournament, either she's a player or she's someone's girlfriend or, better yet, somebody's mom. And, you know, and I guess at the gaming convention.
No booth babes?
I guess at the gaming convention, SGC, there were quite a few gaming girls there, but I think most of them were either, you know, were fans of the site since it was a website-based thing, or they were just, you know, general fans of gaming as real as pretty much people that you would see at a anime convention, because it did have a lot of other stuff, you know, in it, or they were either fans of, you know, the NetLiberties or something. Which is totally cool.
Now, where did that one take place?
That was in Dallas. And, of course, it's not going on anymore.
Oh, that sucks. You got me thinking. I was like, man, that'd be kind of a neat event to go to. But if it ain't happening, oh, well.
Yeah. And then at steampunk convents, you know, there, you know, all the women are of age. And they're mainly...
That also mainly goes to a certain degree for comic book conventions. You know, most of the people are, a lot of the people are going to be, you know, a bit older, you know.
Yeah, it's, I guess, at the steampunk convention, they're mostly, I guess, the girls there are like of a lot older. You'll find a lot older women who partake in this, you know, because you're just going to see the teenage girl dressed up all steampunk, and she's going to be bouncing around, and then her mom is going to be dressed up all steampunk, but her mom's not going to be bouncing around as much. And then at the comic cons, it's a very family friendly environment, and down there, yeah, you will see lots of girls there, you know, perhaps not as many as you would see at an anime con, but all the girls at a comic con, if they're dressed up in a costume, chances are they'll most likely be dressed up as a recognizable character, and they'll be of age.
Yeah, wasn't that the rule that you came up with last time? If you could recognize a character, they're probably of age. If you don't, then, you know, you need to, you know, take your dirty eyes away from that young lady.
That's one of the things that you bring up a good point that leads me into anime cons. And at anime cons, you know, most of the women there, or I shouldn't even say women. Most of the girls there are 14-year-old girls.
Well, they're girls, yeah.
And they're all dressed up, all, you know, and I guess as scantily clad as they can get, because that's the character that they're playing, or that's their character, their OC, as I hear they like to call it, the original character that
they
make up for themselves. And
yeah, I mean, yeah, some of these costumes, I mean, I've seen more cotton on the top of a bottle of aspirin. I mean, just whoa.
And it's like,
and then you feel like a dirty old man for, you know, for looking.
It's and
like,
you pretty much are a dirty old man for looking, because it's like, you know, because I guess the mean age that we're talking about ourselves and people like us are like, you know, late 20s, early 30s. And these are, you know, girls that are pretty much half our age in most cases, you know, just dressed in the thinnest material possible, running around. And it's just, you know, and it's a little disturbing.
It's a little disconcerting, yeah. Yeah, so
it's definitely a very high creepy factor.
Oh, there you go. I like that term.
And one of my, you know, rules are when you're ever at a Comic-Con or any kind of event, if you can recognize the character that a girl is dressed as, she's most likely of age, of legal age. If you cannot recognize the character that she is dressed as, then she is underage. And you got to just, you know, stay away.
Yeah, I think we went over that earlier, but it bears repeating.
Yeah, I just needed to reiterate that, make it clearer.
Oh, cool.
And I guess, you know, you won't see as much, I guess, creepiness at a steampunk con, because it is more family friendly. And let me just go into Etherfest for a bit. As far as the ages, it's mostly... I guess older people, and those who did bring their kids weren't running around being obnoxious and stupid. Their kids, you know, were well behaved. I mean, steampunk parents take care of their kids. They know what their kids are doing.
Ouch.
And if any of the kids were there, is mostly likely, you know, because I guess I'm to blame for that, because my book Steam Pets is very, it's open to the family, but as I understand it, a lot of young readers like to pick it up. And if there are any young kids there, they were either there for gaming, I guess the Cracked Monocle gaming, or
right. Yeah, there was a lot of tabletop stuff going on in that same room.
Or they were there because they were Steam Pets fans, which was, which was, you know, pretty cool. But, you know, they were there, they were having fun, they were dressed up, they were being responsible, you know. And the parents there were being responsible and stuff. And when it was time for the kiddies to go to bed, the kiddies would go to bed, and then they would have nighttime activities, which was mainly aimed at a more mature adult crowd. And, you know, pretty much, I mean...
Yeah, didn't they have, I believe it was a burlesque?
Yeah, they had a burlesque show, and they'll have, like, you know, pirate shows. Sadly, I missed. And they had, like, lots of shows. And also another thing that you'll notice is there's a lot of beer at a steampunk convention.
No mead? Oh, wait, that's pirates. Never mind. My bad.
Or ale. I mean...
Oh, there you go.
I mean, opening ceremonies pretty much began where the chair people... They were just saying, hey, welcome to Etherfest, and they had a beer in their hand. And pretty much, you know, and there was a lot of drinking involved. But it was, you know, people were being responsible, and it wasn't, you know, oh, I'm an outrageous ass. Like you would see at an anime con where, you know, no one's old enough to drink, but there's still outrageous, obnoxious behavior. And that's usually just due to the immaturity of the attendees.
Of the crowd, and, you know, yeah, most of them are away from the folks. I saw a lot of this myself. At Anime Matsuri, which is in Houston, you know, and yeah, I mean, it gets pretty bonkers, you know, with these unsupervised kids running around. But, you know, oh well, what can you do? It's kind of part of that particular scene, I guess.
And at a Comic-Con, you know, I mean, every now and then, yeah, you would see a few obnoxious kids, but it was a family event, and mom and dad weren't far behind, so the kids didn't get into trouble, which is, you know, another thing that I liked.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, there were a lot of I saw a lot of families at Texas Comic Con this past weekend, you know, and yeah, I mean, everybody seemed to be having fun, you know. Like I said, yeah, I mean, you got your occasional little kid running around, but, you know, as you said, mom and dad are usually in their neighborhood and, you know, rein them in and, you know, discipline them or, you know, settle them down and all that good stuff.
That's what I like, is that, you know, the level of responsible parenting. And I guess I cracked a joke lately that, you know, San Japan coming up is, I called it, you know, I was just joking with the one of the con chairs, and I said, you know, San Japan sounds so great. It's going to be like the world's largest 3-day daycare. And, you know, and of course the staff, they laughed and said, you know, that you're right. That's pretty much what it has become, because the staff there have to focus so much on security and training that they actually have to call in the San Antonio police. They have to have a police presence and safety codes, and not just due to the size, but because there are safety concerns when you get that amount of people together. And of course,
in a hotel. But, you know, there's one thing we're leaving out as well, that is unique to anime cons that you don't necessarily see at the other ones. And that is that anime cons, for whatever weirdo reason, you know, tend to run 24/7.
Yeah, there's like so much going on, like all the time.
You know, they'll have like...
they'll have 24-hour viewing rooms.
Yeah, viewing rooms. They'll have, you know... They'll have, you know, I guess, for lack of a better choice of words, they'll have, you know, the dirty stuff playing, you know, at night or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, or Ninja Hell or.
Yeah, they have adult programming, which, you know, will play in the later hours. And.
Well, and the other thing, too, is, you know, the artist area is usually out, you know, in the hallways of the hotel. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't really close it off and say, okay, you know, we're done for the night, you know, go home or go to your room, you know, so that. I think that's part of it. That's something that we haven't quite mentioned yet. Whereas Comic Cons,
I mean, at another thing. You know, let me just bring this up real quick. Is at the anime cons, you know, they're very security driven, and the dealer's alley, they can lock that off. They can close that off and lock it off, the dealer's alley, because they have all, they have vended licensed merchandise. And of course, vendors spend more to get in there.
Right.
And they really, really want to take care of the vendors. I mean, they could care less about the artists. Not saying that they don't. I'm not saying that they don't. It's just, it's not as much.
Come on. I don't think you've had nearly as much grief as I have had, you know.
Well, I mean, I'm not
going to. And I'm not even an artist.
I mean, it's just, you know.
I'd let it out.
The artists have, I guess, less stuff to lose. It's just, it's easier to pack up line art than it is to pack up and put up tons and tons of Naruto dolls and action figures.
Yeah, that's true. Not only that, but, you know, there's value as well. You know, you've got, you know, you might have, let's say, a box of DVDs. Let's assume each one is worth, you know, $10. You know, and there's, you know, 50 DVDs in that box. Hey, and someone swipes it. Hey, you just lost $500.
Yeah, whereas...
You know, whereas artwork...
Artwork is just, you know...
You know, you're selling for $10 a pop.
Yeah, you got like, you know, 10 prints. Well, you know, you really can't gauge that unless you had to count, well, who did it. And this, there's more factors in the value of art, print art, than there is in, I guess, DVDs. Because you can pretty much nail down a DVD's value.
Exactly.
But it's much harder to nail down print art.
Well, and also, you know, also most the majority of your artists, you know, at these anime conventions, you know, don't take this as an insult or whatnot, you know, but they're just not known.
Yeah.
You know, they're up and coming guys. You know, they're you know, working real hard, getting their stuff out. You know, but they haven't really. Most of them have not reached a point, you know, where they can charge even, I'll say, three figures for a piece.
Yeah. Whereas at a Comic-Con, most of the artists there are going to be very well known. And their work is going to be, you know, very, I guess, expensive.
Yeah, a lot of those guys can charge, you know, three, four figures a...
You know, for a commission.
For a piece, right, exactly.
Yeah, and but the thing is, like I said before, it's easier to lock up and to take and to take out prints to your car for the night. It's easier to do that than it is to lock up 2-3 tables of action figures and dolls.
Oh yeah, I mean, because those guys, I mean, we you know, we've seen them, we've been involved in, you know, helping them set up. I mean, that's a lot of stuff to do, so that's a big factor as well, I'd say.
Yeah, so it's easier to lock down the dealers than it is to lock down the artist alleys.
Yep.
Anything else that you would like to bring up in the cross-examination of cultures.
Cross-examination, I like that. No, I think I'm about tapped out. I mean, you know, I can't say I've been to as wide a variety of events as you have. You know, so I don't really have, you know, too much more to cover that we've already talked about.
Yeah. And I guess, you know, I guess now that the steampunk is starting to pick up more steam, it's becoming more popular. That, you know, we're actually starting to see it. I don't know if I'm using the right word here. We're actually starting to see it infect other cons.
That's a good word.
That a lot of, that there's, you know, there was a minor steam presence at Texas Comic Con. I saw maybe two or three vendors who were, I guess, steampunk centric. And also including myself, I guess I would consider myself, you know, a very steampunk artist since I got steam pets, you know.
Well, and you do your commission, your steam commissions of, you know.
Yeah, steampunk pet commissions, and that, I got a lot of repeat business with that.
Well, it's interesting because the presence there is kind of similar to what we saw at the last Realms Con, you know, and also that the last Sand Japan. It was just kind of up and coming, you know, two or three tables at and it might have been the same guys actually because we're in the same neighborhood, you know, and now boom, it's just taken over.
You know, but it was not as strong at Texas Comic Con as we've seen it at other cons. Whereas
I think they'll get there.
Yeah, but
I think they'll get there.
Whereas, like let's say the anime con, you'll see us half of it. I would say half of the culture is steampunked out.
Yeah, and it even extends to the panels. I mean, I think we have two or three steampunk-related panels at San Japan coming up.
Well, I'd say there are more than that.
Oh, well, there we go then.
And then there, and as I was, you know, and the anime cons are practically, you know, half steampunk, you know, and the comic cons, they're not as much, but it's slowly getting there. But I believe that's due to the lack of, I guess.
Well, I think I'd say the lack of a, you know, a definitive work, I guess.
Well, you know
what I mean? Because think about it. You know, if let's say, you know, League of Extraordinary Gentlemen had actually been pretty good and hit, you know, that might have, you know, gotten something going, because it would have been something that people had heard about. You know, that's kind of one of the downsides of steampunk, because it is what you make of it, you know, or what you bring to the table, as Chris mentioned earlier. You know, that can also be a downside, because you kind of have to learn it, I guess. You know, you would say.
And most of the, I guess, celebrities of the steampunk culture, a majority of them are authors.
Right.
And a majority of them are net celebrities. So if people aren't in that circle,
if you're not in that loop,
then, you know, they're not going to make it into a Texas Comic Con.
Well, or they might make it, or
they might make it, but you know,
they'll get in the door, but it kind of, and even then, I think it remains to be seen, you know, how well, you know, those two or three guys did at Texas Comic Con, because remember, we had some more anime influenced artists there last year, you know, that just in terms of sales, at least, did, you know, terrible and just didn't come back this year.
Yeah, and then there's like,
so it'll be interesting to see if we see those, you know, steampunk guys come back.
Well, I mean, I think it was just me at Texas Comic Con as far as steampunk goes.
They say we got 2 to 3.
Well, I was talking about vendors.
Oh, well, potato, potato, I mean.
Yeah, you know, vendors, yeah. But as far as artists, you know, I mean, that's another vice I have, is the lack of steampunk line art artists, that there aren't as much, I guess, steampunk comic books. And it's slowly getting there with titles such as Lady Machina, I believe, or
sounds about right. I couldn't tell you. Or, I don't keep up with that stuff. Come on, you know.
And there's other comic books that are coming out that are more
Time Lincoln. I mean, our own Antarctic Press is kind of big into the whole. I mean, they had a presence at Etherfest, and
yeah, and they brought a huge amount of, I guess, yeah, they did bring a huge amount of. I'm glad you brought that up, of steampunk artwork. And other steampunk
stuff. Books. I mean,
and books.
Yeah, I myself picked up a book called Mighty Tiny, which was I guess you could call a furry, you know, steampunk book that I believe Ben Dunn was the artist that did it quite a number of years ago. It even has the old Antarctic Press logo that has, you know, the continent of Antarctica on it. Which, and by the way, I really enjoyed the book. It was a really neat, you know, really neat adventure story to read.
Yeah, I just have to say is that, you know, as the steampunk, as it grows more, we're going to probably see, you know, as it creates a more comic book illustrative presence, because, you know, I really don't, I'm pretty sure that there are a number of steampunk illustrators and artists out there.
Right.
But it's just in the Texas San Antonio area that will come down here and be a part of the events that we have. Like, we just had the one event, which was the Etherfest. There was just, I believe, myself and another artist. And I'm pretty sure that there were a few more, but, you know, it just wasn't a dominant presence. It was more about, you know, authors and bloggers and net celebrities than it was about visual artists.
Well, I mean, I think it'll get there. I mean, it's like everything else, you know. It takes a while to creep up, you know. And also, you know, you got to remember, we're in San Antonio, so we're usually, what, 3 or 5 years behind everybody else. You know, so, you know, who knows? Perhaps we'll, when Etherfest comes back next year, you know, perhaps we'll see some more artists, and you'll like, have other people to talk to and stuff.
Yeah, other people to compete with.
You know, and
other people who...
Instead of your douchey friend that wears a t-shirt, you know, just to make a weird point.
Yeah. I mean, it's...
We had our panel that day, too. I feel kind of bad about that now.
Yep.
You know, because, you know, you're all duded up and everything. And I was the only person in the doggone room that was not dressed up, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, and...
So I was kind of like, yeah.
Sorry. Yeah, but I mean, it's a fun event, and it can only grow.
Don't spit on me.
And I'm glad to see it grow. But,
yeah, I mean, it's really neat. It's really neat stuff, and you know, And I think it's, yeah, it's only going to get bigger.
And as for the anime con, you know, I mean, all the artists there are pretty much talented, and it is a great presence. But, I mean, you have a few people who, of course, you know, stand head above shoulders above everyone else. And a lot of them, it is very, you know, I guess, fan art centric. But then also at the Texas Comic Con, there is a large fan art presence as well.
Yeah, that's most of it, I'd say.
Whereas at the Steampunk Con, you know, since it's such a vague description, you really can't call it really fan art.
Yeah, I mean, unless you're drawing, you know, someone out of, you know, League of Extraordinary Gentlemen or, you know, heck, I can't even think of anything else, to be quite honest. You know, maybe some of the Doctor Who stuff.
Yeah, other than that, you know, there's very little room for fan art stuff. It's usually all just original stuff or what, like I said, what you make of it, you know, people's characters.
Right.
And whatever it is that they bring into it.
Cool.
And then at the Texas Comic Cons, of course, you have, you know, tons of fan art. It's like, you know, practically nothing but fan art. And it's, you do have your original creators there, which is great. But they're mostly overshadowed by people that, you know, have like tons and tons of prints of Green Lantern or Superman and stuff like that. Not that there's anything wrong with that. It's just the nature of the beast. And at the anime cons, you know, there's tons of fan art, but I hear that a lot of more the lawyers are getting involved in it.
Well, we all know that's never good.
And I guess they're sort of, you know, drawing back fan art. I hear that.
I see what you did there. Drawing back.
Yeah.
Get it? Badoom-tish.
And,
had to point that out.
Now, at a more, I guess, established anime front, I guess it's at Akon, they actually have, I believe, either a 20 or 10% fan art rule.
Really?
On their, you have to look this up on their forums. But they have some kind of fan art rule where they can only allow a certain amount of fan art because, you know, lawyers, of course, have gotten involved and so many industry people are there because it's so big that they don't like seeing their properties or, I guess, representatives of various properties don't want to feel that, you know, their rights are being infringed upon.
Right.
By the selling of fan art. You know, it's like, because, you know, people are like, well, either I could buy this really cool print of Naruto by this famous net celebrity artist, or I could buy a DVD of Naruto. And, you know.
Right, an official, you know,
Funimation. An official DVD, DVD. And, you know, that sort of impacts in their sales enough that I guess they'll send a lawyer, of course. You know, I'm just paraphrasing here. So, you know, I mean, Google it yourself and look it up, but that's what I believe so far.
Yeah, and I remember hearing rumblings about, you know, maybe even, you know, San Japan might start, you know, implementing something, you know, along those lines.
Yeah, it hasn't hit us in the San Antonio area yet, but, you know, the anime conventions are sort of getting, you know,
their ears are
perking up to
well,
the
yeah,
issue.
I mean, as the numbers increase. You know, because, you know, when you had, you know, 2,000 attendees, I mean, they're not really, you're not even a blip on the radar, you know, but once it, as it grows and, you know, you get more numbers, then, yeah, you're going to attract some attention sooner or later.
Yeah. And I guess at, you know, Texas Comic Con, I guess that sort of thing, it's not that it's not enforced. It's just they have a different method of handling it.
Well, they tolerate it to a certain degree. And
yeah.
You know, if they like it enough, you know, they can just say, yoink, thank you.
They can use it and they'll credit you, but you won't get a dime for it because it is, you know, their character. And we're talking about, you know, fan art in relation to, I guess, American comics.
Right.
Mostly the established Marvel and DC, I believe. As far as the smaller press, I don't know what their policies are.
They probably
are.
Don't have the resources.
Yeah,
No. Well, in any event, we're almost at an hour, so I think we'll wrap it up. Chris, any final words?
At the moment, no. I mean, sure, we've compared and contrast and all these events and stuff, but, you know, we definitely don't want to discourage you from going to any of them.
Oh, no, definitely. Yeah, I mean, if you're into, you know, any of these, you know, types of fandoms, you know, be they anime, comic, you know, steampunk,
it
gaming,
sounded like
sci-fi.
We were coming down hard like bitter old men, but that's mostly
you,
because
not me. I mean,
Okay, I guess it sounded like I came down hard for being a bitter old man, but that's mostly because I am a bitter old man, and I can't do cartwheels with Chris Ayers in the anime cons anymore. So these are just to serve as cautionary tales of what you expect.
One can dream, Chris.
Yeah, this is just we're just giving hints of what we've observed
and what you can probably expect.
Yeah, what you can expect, but in no way should this discourage you from attending a convention. If you love anime, check out San Japan. If you love artwork and original artwork, go to San Japan anyways. Because there is a great number of artists out there, and it's also a great way to get little trinkets and cool licensed toys.
Yeah, and check out some cool panels. I mean, we'll be there ourselves.
I mean, if you want to have plenty to do, then yes, definitely go check out San Japan. If you want to lose 15 pounds, you'll lose them at San Japan. And I guess at Texas Comic Con, it's a great place to go to see if you're really into comic books and if you're really into art. Definitely check that one out as well.
Well, and I'm intrigued to see what kind of guests they come up with next year.
Yeah, and definitely big-name guests.
Yeah, because, it's getting bigger.
Yeah, there's going to be someone that you're going to recognize. Like we said, it's so recognizable. Just show up there, and you'll see something that you love and you have to have.
Yeah. Oh, I have to bring this up since we're talking about Texas Comic Con. I was promised the General Lee, and I did not get the General Lee at Texas Comic Con, so worst convention ever. No, not really, Nasser. You're cool.
Yeah, you'll see lots of recognizable stuff, and it's a great thing to go to, but you got to understand it's a bit more, I guess, you'll see more established licensed properties. Now, if you're a do-it-yourselfer and you love little trinkets or something completely original and off the wall, then that's where Etherfest is totally for you. That you find these something completely original and imaginative. And if you want to go to another world, another time.
That's a good way to put it.
Etherfest is definitely for that sort of, I guess, extra.
Extra layer of immersion. Yeah, probably the best way to put it.
Yeah, I guess it's very immersive and it's very easy to immerse yourself into.
Well, and especially since they had it at the St. Anthony Hotel. That's a beautiful hotel. I mean, and then, the costumes being from, not necessarily the time period, but probably in that same neighborhood. Those people look like, like they belong there when the hotel was brand new.
Yeah,
it was really neat.
It's something creative and new, but until more artists get involved, you're going to do a lot of reading.
Oh, boy.
But, definitely read Steam Pets.
Nice plug there. Nice plug there. And, of course, if you want to get your pew, pew, pew on, there's the gaming conventions, which, sadly, we don't really have any, here in the San Antonio area. Not too sure about Austin.
Yeah. I mean, but, one day it could happen. I mean, other than a game developer conference, which I think happens in Austin. But, if you're really good at Halo Reach, then, yeah, definitely check out one of the tournaments or go to if you're good at Street Fighter or something, drag your girlfriend along to or have your mom drop you off at one of OG's events.
Yeah. Sorry, dude, he went there.
And you'll see plenty of women there. It's just they're going to be the ones who are going to beat you at Street Fighter.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, which oddly enough, some people might find attractive, so. Let's not go there.
Of course, you'll have to wait for to go to the anime con to actually see someone dressed up as Chun-Li.
All about the thighs, baby. Yeah. Well, we'll go ahead and wrap up on that note. Thank you for listening. I am Eduardo Solis. The next episode of 300 Seconds will be posted once I figure out what I'm going to dress up for San Japan.